Tardigrades are microscopic animals so adaptable they can be found in extreme environments, even Antarctica and volcanic vents deep in the ocean.
Tardigrades are like a extremely charismatic organism to work with. They're cute. They have little eye spots and eight little legs.
Many scientists, like Dr. Thomas Boothby, have tested the toughness of these so-called water bears with creative experiments. They've been shot out of a gun, frozen nearly to absolute zero, and exposed to the vacuum of space for 10 days.
So we know that they're very tough, but we don't really know how they're doing that.
To find out how, Boothby sent water bears up to the International Space Station and also down into the ocean with his aquanaut colleague, Dr. Hunter Hines.
Scientists are really looking at how we can stress out tardigrades and what we might learn from their adaptations.
Let's get a close-up look at two new tardigrade experiments and what we hope to learn from them.
So here we have a freshwater tardigrade. This one's about 200 microns in length, 1,000 microns on a millimeter. Tardigrades are really good, you know, microbial predators. That green coloration is actually ingested algae that's within it.
Dr. Hines is an avid scuba diver. He goes on these really cool aquanaut missions where he took tardigrades down into the ocean and left them there for extended periods of time at increased pressure. I think it'll be really, really cool to compare the data sets that we get from the aquanaut mission to the spaceflight mission and sort of see how these animals are able to cope with disparate extremes of environments.
So Dr. Boothby has a fabulous molecular lab set up. He was able to send me these tardigrades, the exact same batch from the space experiments, in the mail, basically overnighting them to me. They come in these small tubes. They're kept cool as they ship across the country, and then we're able to just pull them out, get them back to ambient temperature, and the tardigrades are fine with that.
To conduct the pressure test, Dr. Hines packs up his water bears and gear in dry boxes and triple bags them for the journey to the Jules Underwater Lodge, which is only accessible by scuba diving down into a saltwater lagoon.
So basically, we take it down to just about 30 feet, and the habitat has a moon pool. Basically, it has an opening at the very bottom underneath the habitat, which is just kept open by the pressure.
So we're breathing compressed air down here at 30 feet, so it's actually like a 24-hour long scuba dive. And you can feel the effects of pressure. You feel it a little bit in your head, you definitely feel it a little bit in your lungs. That's the extra about 14 pounds of pressure pushing down on you as you take each breath. And then, of course, it's affecting the tardigrades, it's affecting me, it's affecting the bag of chips. As you can see, these chip bags didn't do so well, as the air inside them compresses down. Kind of the opposite of what happens on an airplane when they expand.
Air is pumped in from the surface, and the habitat, which dates back to the early 1970s, is equipped with sensors that keeps tabs on the gas levels in the space.
Once you're saturated, you can stay down there as long as you'd like.
Once Dr. Hines settles in, his 24-hour experiment begins.
So the hypothesis was that tardigrades would be affected by the pressure, and that would be reflected in the molecular data. I took down a portable microscope, which can go up to 1,000 times magnification.
All right, so the cool thing of being here in this undersea habitat is we can actually observe these tardigrades live at pressure. At 1 hour, they're fine. But now after about 12 hours, they're really showing some signs of this barometric pressure affecting them. They're a lot more sluggish, they're kind of compressing a little bit, and that's all due to this added stress of the pressure. So it'd be really interesting to get them back to Dr. Boothby's lab and see exactly what's happening to them at a genetic level.
But to determine what exact genes are responding to the high-pressure environment, Dr. Hines will somehow have to provide Dr. Boothby back at the lab with a snapshot of the underlying molecular profile of the water bears every hour. But how?
We put a chemical preservative on them, which basically stabilizes a certain type of molecule called RNA. Cells take DNA and transcribe it into RNA. If we look at what RNA is being made, we can get an idea of which genes in our DNA are active.
So once the experiment was completed and we cleaned all our gear up, we were able to pack up these different tubes very carefully, and we just sent them in the mail back to Dr. Boothby's lab.
From aquanauts, we turn to astronauts, 254 miles above Earth, who performed a similar experiment, also under the direction of Dr. Boothby.
So in space, there's two main stressors that we know of. One is being in microgravity. The other is once you leave Earth's atmosphere, you're exposed to a lot more radiation. The tardigrades are exposed to the exact same conditions that astronauts are. We prepared our animals in just these sort of small tubes, and from the Kennedy Space Center, they went up on a SpaceX rocket to the space station. It was a really interesting process getting to work with the astronauts, but at every step in the process, we could communicate with them, see what they were doing, they could ask us questions. What you have here are some photos of a French astronaut, Thomas. Essentially, he's got his hands in a glove box to help contain any sort of biological material that might escape. Thomas did a really amazing job taking care of our little water bears up there for us.
Similar to the deep sea experiment, the role of the astronauts was to provide Dr. Boothby with a freeze frame image of which specific DNA was active at 1 week and then at 61 days using the same chemical preservative.
Once we put this chemical preservative on the animals, they're no longer alive. That will kill them, but it will preserve their RNA as it was at that exact moment indefinitely. The 7-day samples are sort of the founding generation that came from Earth. The 61-day samples are tardigrades that were born in space and have never been on Earth before. Are there differences in genes from terrestrial tardigrades here on Earth versus in space? If we can understand how the tardigrades are surviving in these conditions over multiple generations, maybe we can develop technology that would allow humans to have a more safe, prolonged presence in space. If we want to go to Mars, for example, or if we want to set up a permanent moon base, these are sort of stresses that people are going to need to deal with.
Once this experiment concluded, the preserved tardigrades hitched a ride back to Earth on the latest SpaceX rocket, making a supply run to the ISS.
They're now in our freezer in our lab, and we're working to extract the RNA. We'll be taking a look at what RNA is present and what genes were activated under these different stressful conditions.
Although the data from these two experiments won't be ready for analysis for several months, Dr. Boothby's previous experiments on tardigrades have yielded some potential real-world applications.
Some of the exciting things that we found is that tardigrades, they have unique genes that only tardigrades have. The proteins that are made from these tardigrade genes, they're actually very amorphous. They kind of are constantly changing their shape. So they're what we call intrinsically disordered proteins.
Some of these mutable, unbreakable tardigrade proteins help keep the animals alive in a state of suspended animation, even when 99% of the water in their bodies dries up.
Tardigrades aren't the only organism that can do this. Look at plant seeds, for example. That's basically the embryo of a plant that can persist in a dry state. But what we found is that if we take these proteins and put them into other systems, like bacteria or yeast, we can make those organisms more desiccation tolerant. They're able to stabilize biological material in a dry state. We can try and make, let's say, crop plants more tolerant to drought. The Pfizer vaccine for COVID needs to be stored at negative 80 degrees. Imagine if you could mix it with these tardigrade proteins, stabilize it in a dry state, and not have to store it under these really stringent conditions. The application we're working on right now is the stabilization of human blood in a dry state. Having dried, powdered blood that you can add liquid back to and reconstitute it and use it as needed would be a sort of huge boon to health pursuits.
Powdered blood that can be shipped and stored without refrigeration? Is that possible?
We're working on this now. We've seen some really promising results with certain blood cell types. Very excited to see what comes out of this in the future.
If this experiment turns out to show some kind of novel adaptations and perhaps some new avenues to pursue for different kind of benefits to society, I think tardigrades will continue to be tested in these extremes.
So the hardy tardigrade, the mighty moss piglet, continues to endure and teach us valuable lessons about how they adapt to whatever the Earth and the cosmos throws at them.